today we have new findings out on adolescence. Tell us why it's important to look at HIV prevention in adolescents.
So as somebody gets older and reaches the age of sexual debut, by definition, they are then being introduced to potential exposure to HIV. So what better time to help prevent the continued growth of the HIV epidemic than to engage adolescents and youth in HIV prevention activities? That said, we need to make sure that we have the best tools available for adolescents.
And so the results out today look at two different tools in adolescents, the vaginal ring and PrEP. Tell us a little bit about what these are as background for our viewers.
Well, let's start with the vaginal ring. The vaginal ring was is a ring, literally, made of sort of like a soft vinyl that goes into the vagina and releases the medication that would prevent HIV infection directly into the vagina. It's worn for 28 days, and then upon menses, it's replaced. It was just completed phase 3 trials in sub-Saharan Africa, and has now moved toward licensure in the European Medicines Association. The issue is it was tested in people 18 years and older. So the purpose of this study is to look at how the ring is taken up and used or utilized by young women.
And what about daily oral PrEP?
So daily,
that's something hopefully our daily, viewers are familiar with.
Yes, so I imagine our viewers are quite familiar with daily oral PrEP, which is a one pill, once a day combination of tenofovir plus a drug called FTC. And it has been shown to be incredibly effective if you are adherent to the medication. The issue has always been the question of adherence, and adolescents in general tend to be very poorly adherent. And the purpose of this study was to look and see if here in South Africa, if it were possible to get to a point where adolescents would be willing to use PrEP and then stay on PrEP for a period of time.
And so for the study looking at PrEP in adolescents in South Africa, which was led by IAS President Linda Gail Becker, what did the study find?
So the study found that was actually reasonable uptake of PrEP, and not only that was there reasonable uptake, but there was also reasonable adherence and reasonable durability associated with this relatively young population in the Cape Town area.
Great. And how about for the ring?
The ring had a similar result, that it seemed to be usable and not, by these populations. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, the ring is a little bit further away from availability, but, you know, progress.
Great. And so you mentioned availability. Can adults get these interventions now, or can adolescents get them? Where are they?
So the ring is not currently available. Like I said, it's moving toward licensure, and that's a decision that will be made, and then will have to come in and manufacture the ring and to make it available. PrEP is available to adults, and it depends on what your country's current Ministry of Health has determined would happen. In the United States, it's clearly available by prescription. In South Africa, the Ministry of Health has determined that it's available to certain target populations. And so it's an evolving story around the globe. And I think that's an important point, is that we're moving toward implementation of pre-exposure prophylaxis globally.
And we often talk about how we need different tools for different populations, for different people's lives, and so this is hopefully something that can come in to work for those groups, right?
Exactly. So over time, we have seen, you know, condoms. We've had adult medical male circumcision. This would be a tool, two examples of simpler tools that could be utilized by both men and women, particularly the pill, to prevent HIV infection.
Wonderful. And so these studies were unique in some respects. There were some firsts associated with these studies. For the ring, it was the first study to include younger women and they were studied in the U.S., is that right?
Yes, they were. And I think that was a really important step forward, is to demonstrate safety as well as usability in these populations, in U.S. populations, and then that will make it easier for us to move this kind of technology overseas, because, you know, the work first needs to be done at home.
And this was Linda Gale's study was also the first to look at adolescent girls using oral PrEP, correct?
And I think that's one of the, if you take a moment and step back and look at the challenges we face with the burgeoning epidemic in sub-Saharan Africa, young women in the from the ages of 15 to 25 are the most at-risk population. So the fact that Linda Gale Becker and the team was able to get this kind of a study launched in women under 18 was a real milestone. And further, that they were able to figure out how to enable these young women to access this technology in a way that they could do it in a durable fashion was a really important step forward for the field.
And one thing that I think we should clarify about these studies, so these are not efficacy trials. These are studies looking at safety and if the participants in the study were able to adhere, correct?
Correct. These are, in many ways, this is the start of a research agenda in both of these cases. Is this feasible is the question, and the answer to both was yes.
That's great. And what are the next steps?
So the next step on the ring is getting toward licensure. There are other studies going on that will begin in terms of continuing to explore utilization. I think we're moving into the field of full implementation and implementation research. With PrEP, it is largely about demonstration projects. PEPFAR has a series of projects called the DREAM studies that's also looking at pre-exposure prophylaxis in young women. And I think these combinations of South African-led plus PEPFAR-led studies in sub-Saharan Africa will really help us get to a point where pre-exposure prophylaxis, the space that can occupy in HIV prevention will be defined in a good way.